गुड मॉर्निंग टू एवरीवन। सो इन द प्रीवियस क्लास,
गुड
गुड मॉर्निंग। सो इन द प्रीवियस क्लास वी हैव स्टार्टेड टॉकिंग अबाउट द कंजेशन कंट्रोल। सो फॉर कंजेशन कंट्रोल देयर आर मेनी पॉलिसीज फॉर कंट्रोल द कंजेशन। सो फॉर कंजेशन कंट्रोल वी हैव टू policies present, mainly the two policies, that is one for the open loop and another for the closed loop. For open loop is used for the prevention. One is mainly that in operating system also you have known that for deadlock prevention and deadlock avoidance there are two ways. Same as that here also for the congestion. To control congestion we have two ways. One is to prevent the congestion and another is of the removal or the congestion, removal of the congestion. So in the congestion for we have for the first we will discuss about the prevention and then we will go to discussion about the removal of the congestion. So in between the prevention for congestion prevention we have already discussed two policies. One is the retransmission policy and another is the window policy, which we have already discussed. Now, today, in the prevention case, we will discuss some policies, and after this, we will go to the removal of the congestion. We will go to the removal of the congestion policies. So, first, we will discuss the prevention policies. Now, there is the prevention policy, that is the acknowledgement policy. Now, acknowledgement policy is what? Acknowledgement policy is used for the prevention of congestion. Now, the acknowledgement policy, which is imposed by the receiver, can also affect the cause of the congestion. That means, based on this, the congestion may occur. Let's say, for example, there is a sender present and another one is the receiver. So, sender will send what? Sender will send packet to the receiver. And receiver, after receiving this packet from sender, it will give a acknowledgement to the sender. So sender sends packet, receiver then receives it, and after receiving, it will send the acknowledgement. And this acknowledgement is received by the sender. So that's how the process should be go on. Now, if this process continues, that means if the receiver immediately sends the acknowledgement, the receiver is immediately sends the acknowledgement, then the sender will do what? Sender will sends the packet. So one by one, the sender will sends packet and it will receives the acknowledgement. Then it will sends packet, then it will receives the acknowledgement. Like this process will continue. Now, if this process continues, then there may happen that it lead to the congestion. So there may be any policy should be present that the receiver will send acknowledgement. Yes, after sender sends the packet, receiver will receives the acknowledgement, receiver receives the packet and sends the acknowledgement. It's okay. But after some time period, if any policy can be implemented that the receiver will send acknowledgement after a time period, or after receiving N packets from the sender, then the congestion can be controlled. Because if sender sends one packet, then again acknowledgements, then again packet sent, then again acknowledgement received. Like this, if this process continues, then it lead to congestion. It may lead to congestion. But if some implementation of policies can present that sender sends packet to the receiver and receiver receives that packet also. But receiver wait for some time, and after waiting from some time, then receiver sends the acknowledgement to the receive sender. Or after receiving n number of packets, from the sender, receiver sends the acknowledgement. Then what it will be? It will control the congestion. The congestion can be controlled. This is what the acknowledgement policy is. So if we affect if we make some policies like that, then it will really helpful to make the congestion control. So this is one of the congestion prevention policies. The next policy is discarding policy. The next policy is discarding policy. Now, what is the discarding policy? Now, in this scenario, in this discarding policy, that sender sends packet to the receiver. Sender sends packet to the receiver. Now, among some packets, so there is not like that, that one packet is sent, but after that, no packet should be sent. Not, it is not like that. The packets can be continuously sent like that. It happens. So there may be some scenario that some packet contains less information, that sender is sending packets to the receiver. Now, the packets which the sender is sending, among them, some packets must be present or may be present that contain less sensitive information, or let's say some extra information which is not so much important. Then discarding this less sensitive information packet also prevent the congestion. This is the discarding policy. That sender is sending packet, send, it is that sender first packet sent, second packet sent, third packet sent. Sender is sending like that packets one by one. Among them, some packets may be present that contains less information and not so much important. So if we can able to discard this packet, then prevention of congestion can happen. That congestion can be controlled in that case. So discarding policy is one of another congestion prevention techniques. That is discarding policy. And last is the admission policy. Now, what is admission policy? It is basically a quality of service mechanism. We will discuss what the quality of service mechanism is. But first, you know that it is basically a quality of service mechanism. And in this, switches flow fast, check the resource requirement. The resource requirement is checked first. And before admitting it to the network, that the resource requirement is checked before admitting to the network, means at first check how many resource it needed. At first check how many resource is needed, then only admit it into the network. Then only admit it into the network. So basically resource are checked first before admitting to the network. That means like there is a switch and it has 20 frames together. In that 20 frames are present. Then admission policy, this admission policy will check that if this 20 frames are sent and according to it, resource are available or not. That the frames that is sent according to it, resource are available or not. If the resource are available, then only send. Otherwise, it will not send. If it is available, the resource are available for providing the 20 frames, for providing this 20 frames, for resource to provide this 20 frames, then only send it. Otherwise, do not send. This is what the admission policy, that first check how many resource it needed, how many resources needed, and according to it, what? Admit to the network. According to it, admit it into the network. This is what the admission policy is. So this total five techniques, the two techniques that I have discussed previously, previous class, retransmission policy and window policy, and these three policies, that first is the acknowledgement policy, then discarding policy, and third is this admission policy. So these five policies, if these five policies are used for the congestion prevention, for prevention of the congestion, these policies are used. Clear? समझ में आया सबको? समझ में आया सबको कि प्रिवेंशन पॉलिसीज जो जो है उज्जवल डॉली।
यस सर।
ओके सो दिस इज व्हाट द कॉन्जेशन प्रिवेंशन, दिस इज व्हाट अबाउट द कॉन्जेशन प्रिवेंशन। नाउ देयर इज आल्सो अनदर थिंग इज व्हाट वी डिस्कस दैट कॉन्जेशन रिमूवल, अनदर इज द कॉन्जेशन रिमूवल। So, what is the congestion removal? For this also, for congestion removal, there is also some policies present. We will discuss one by one of these policies. So, for removal of the congestion, the first policy is back pressure. The first policy is the back pressure. Now, what is this? In this, the congested node. The congested node means where the particular node in which the congestion occurred, the particular node in which the congestion is occurred is known as the congested node. That means in this congested node, it stops receiving data from the other nodes. That means it will stop receiving the data from the other node. So let's say an example, you see in this example, there is a source present and it is the destination. So there is a one source present and another one is the destination. So to travel the data from source to destination, it should travel via N1, N2, N3, N4. So via this node, via this four node, the data travel from source to destination. That means from source to N1, node one, the data will travel. From node one to node two, the data will travel. From node 2 to node 3, the data will travel. From node 3 to node 4, the data will travel. And then from node 4 to the destination, the data will travel and it will reach the destination. So from source to destination, the data will travel via node 1, node 2, node 3, and node 4. These four nodes, the data will travel. Now, let's say among them, node 3 is the congested node. This node become congested. That means congestion occurred in this particular node. So this N3 becomes the congested node. Now what if this N3 becomes congested node? If this N3 become the congested node, N3 will do what? It will immediately stop receiving data. It will immediately stop receiving data from its previous node. That means if N3 is congested node, that means it will immediately stop receiving data from its previous node. So N3's previous node is what? N2. So that means from N2, it will stop receiving data. Same as that, N2 will stop receiving data from its previous node. So the previous node of N2 is what? The previous node of N2 is N1. So that means N2 will stop receiving data from N1. Then N1 also do what? N1 also stop receiving data from its previous node. Now N1's previous node is what? N1's previous node is the source. So that means N1 will stop receiving data from the source. Now, if we look over this, what happens here? We are giving a back pressure. Let's say we are giving a back pressure in the opposite direction of the data flow so that we can able to stop receiving packet. This is what we are doing, that we are giving a back pressure. That means from N3, N3 will stop receiving data from N2. N2 will stop receiving data from N1, and N1 will stop receiving data from the source. Now the data flow is what? Data flow is in this direction. In this direction, the data is flowing. And we are giving a back pressure. That means from N3, N2 will stop receiving data. From N2, N1, from N1, N2 will stop receiving data. Now, then again, N1 will stop receiving data from source. So that means we are giving a back pressure in opposite direction of the data flow. Now, what purpose of this back pressure? To stop receiving the packet. This is a way the congestion can be removed. Now, back pressure is what? Back pressure is the node-to-node congestion control. Back pressure is the node-to-node congestion control that starts from the congested node. That means the back pressure started from the congested node and propagates up to the source. You see, N3 is the congested node. So from here, the back pressure started and the back pressure completed in, and propagates up to or completed up to here in the source. So that means back pressure propagates up to the source. And it always applied to the opposite direction of the data flow. So this is a policy for the congestion removal. So it is a policy that may be applied for the congestion removal. That is the back pressure. Okay. So this is what a policy, that is back pressure. The next is the choke packet. This is another policy for removal of it, for removal of congestion. This is another policy, that is the choke packet. Now in this, a packet is sent by the node, or we can say from a packet is sent by a congested node to the source to inform about its congestion. So same example we are taking, same diagram we are taking, that here the source present and here the destination, and the travel data is traveling from source to destination via node 1, node 2, node 3 and node 4. So let's say in the scenario, node 3 becomes congested. In this scenario, node 3 becomes congested. So in case of this, node 3 will do what? It will send a choke packet. It will send a choke packet. Now what this choke packet contains? Choke packet contains the information of the congested node. Choke packet contains the information of the congested node. So congested node will do what? It will send the choke packet to the source. Now choke packet will send by the congested node to the source to inform the congestion has occurred. That means choke packet contains information about the congestion. And when source will receive that, when source will receive the choke packet, then it immediately stops sending the data. It will immediately stop sending the data. So choke packet is what? It is sent by the congested node. It will be sent by the congested node to the source to inform about the congestion. And source will do what? When it will receive the choke packet, it will immediately stop sending the data. This is what the working of the choke packet. So this is what the another policy of the congestion removal. Then the third is the implicit signaling. The third is the implicit signaling. Now implicit signaling is what? Now implicit signaling is no communication between the congested node with other nodes or a source. That means no communication between the congested node with the other nodes or a source. Or no communication will be between them, congested node or other nodes and the source. Source assumes that when there will be the no communication, source assumes that the congestion occurred. It assumes that if no communication between the node with the other node or the source, then it will do what? It will assume that the congestion is already occurred. Now, based on this assumption is done, like now, how? how the source will assume that? How will source assume? The source will assume like if the acknowledgement is not received, or either for receiving the acknowledgement, that is either delay in receiving the acknowledgement, then only source will assume, yes, there may be the congestion is occurred. That's why I am not able to receive the acknowledgement, or I have that the acknowledgement which I have received after some time, that means delay is already occurred. That's why that much time, after that much time, I have received here this packet acknowledgement. So source will then assume it, that already congestion has occurred. So any of this situation source face, then the congestion occurred. Source assume congestion occurs, and source will do what? It will slow itself. It will slow itself means the rate in which it is sending, that time it is sending the packet, it reduces its speed or reduces its rate of sending the packet. And after waiting some time, it will send packet again. This is what the implicit signaling. Here, no extra signal is present. Source will what? Automatically assume it. In this case, if you see these two previous policies, that is the back pressure and the choke packet. In that case, the congested node is doing what? The congested node is informing the source. The congested node is informing the source. In case of choke packet, congested node is sending the choke packet to the source, that to saying that congestion is occurred. So that's why I've sent the choke packet. So stop sending the data. Same as that back pressure also, the back pressure is going in the opposite direction of the data flow. But in this implicit signaling, if you see, there is no like that. There is no extra signal is present. There is no extra signal is present. It will do what? If a source not able to receive the acknowledgement, or if the delay of receiving the acknowledgement, source will automatically assume it. Automatically assume it, and it will do what? It will slow down. It will slow down, and after some time, it will send the packet. This is what the implicit signaling is. And this is the difference. This is the difference between them. And after that, another one which is left, it is the explicit signaling. Now, explicit signaling is what? The congested node send a signal to the source or destination. Now, congested node will do what? Congested node will send the signal to the source or destination in whichever portion it will be. It will either send signal to the source, or either it will send the signal to the destination. And this signal is included in the data packet. This signal is included in the data packet. Now you may ask that there is also the choke packet is present. So same choke packet and explicit signaling working is the same. You may happen the explicit signaling and choke packet are same, but not, they are not same. The difference between the choke packet and the explicit signaling is, in choke packet, we create a packet separately. In this choke packet concept, a packet is created separately. This choke packet is created separately, and it contains the information of the congestion, and this packet is sent by the congested node to the source. But in case of explicit signaling, this packet, the packet which should be sent by the congested node, it is already included within the signal. It is already included within the signal. Now, this signal can be two types, that is backward or forward. Backward means from node to source, and forward means from node to destination. This is also a different. Choke packet is only sent from the congested node, and this is a packet created separately, and this packet will be sent to the source. But the difference of this explicit signaling is that the packet which is already included within the signal, and this signal can be sent from congested node to the source or congested node to the destination. If it is sent from congested node to the source, then we say it is the backward, or if we send it from congested node to the destination, then we can say it as a forward. This is the thing of the explicit signaling. So this is all about the congestion techniques. This is all about this congestion techniques. So for congestion prevention, we have five techniques present. What are these five techniques? Retransmission policy, window policy, then admission policy, and admission policy, discarding policy, and acknowledgement policy. These five policies are present. And for removal of congestion, four policies are present: back pressure, choke packet, implicit signaling, and explicit signaling. Remember this because it is very much important. So for congestion prevention and congestion removal policies, always remind or always study that, because it is very much important for in your exam. Okay, so this is what our congestion control, two controlling ways, prevention and what, removal. Okay, clear till now? Till now, yes, it is sir. Clear? Okay. So this is what about our congestion control. Now I have mentioned a term during the admission policy, that is the quality of service. I have mentioned that term. Now what basically the quality of service means? Quality of the service is we try to create an appropriate environment for a traffic. We have to create the appropriate environment. So for appropriate environment for a traffic, we have to create in the quality of service. Now, what is the traffic means? What is the traffic means? This traffic means not the car in the jam. The traffic in the networking means is basically the flow of packet or data. Traffic in a networking means what? The traffic in the networking means basically flow of packet or a data. This is the traffic means. So the flow of packet or data in the appropriate environment. So providing the appropriate environment for going or correctly flowing the packet or the data, the quality of the service is needed. Now, for flowing characteristics is needed. What are these flowing characteristics? Now, first characteristics is the reliability. Now, what is the reliability means? The reliability means the packet reached its destination. That means, let's say our network is reliable. We are saying that our network is reliable. So how we can know that our network is reliable? That means we are able to know that our network is reliable, that if source is sending the data and, or say source is sending the packet, any of this, and receiver is able to receive it fully. That means know the particular packet which is sent by the sender, that particular packet is received by the receiver. No alteration has done there. That means no information is loose or not. Information is not lost. Or the particular packet which is sent, it is received by the receiver. Then only we can say that it is reliable. So basically, it is the characteristics of the flow needs. A lack of reliability means, that means a lack of reliability will be what? That the packet which is sent by the sender, let's say the packet is sent by the sender, it is not received by the receiver. So this is, the network is not reliable. So midway in the channel, it is lost. It may happen in the midway of the channel, it is lost. Or the acknowledgement, the receiver sends acknowledgement, but sender doesn't able to receive the acknowledgement. So for a good flow, reliability is very much needed. For a good flow of packets, our reliability is very much needed. That means whatever the data or the packet which is sent by the sender, that particular packet or the data will be received by the receiver. No alteration, no losing, then we can say that our network is reliable. So it is the very much, it is our goal that it reliability is the very much needed for a good flow. Then next is the delay. Delay is basically that delay is what? Basically the time for reaching a packet. Reaching a packet, how much time is needed from sender to receiver? A packet has to be transferred. Then for reaching the packet, how much time is needed from source to the destination? That time, that particular time is called delay. Now, there are different delays, and we also set preferences for delays. Now, let's example, if we say that some delays, we can say some delay, we cannot tolerate some delays. Like that, if there is online conversation going on, that is like this Zoom application where I am teaching. So if there is delay, that means I am doing or you have studying something and I am saying something, but what I am saying, you didn't able to properly hear that. Then it is what? It is the delay. It is the delay that my audio is not going to your front. So this is the delay. This is the delay. So different. Now these delays cannot be tolerated. Why? There is, if you are studying something, but my audio is not going in that range. So that means what? This delay should be minimum. This delay should be minimum. So whenever I am teaching, the delay should be minimum for the audio to reach in your front. The delay should be minimum. But in case of, if you see, in the case of example, if you see, I am sending a mail. So the mail, it is not very much that the mail, maybe sometime after the mail can be received by the receiver. So the delay can be maximum. There is not so much problem. So this is what our delay says. That is what our different delays are present. The delay is different. Like this example, if you see, this is what in the first case, the delay should be minimized. Otherwise, you shouldn't able to understand what I am saying. So that means in this case, the delay should be minimum. But in the second case, if you see the in the case of mail, if I am sending the mail and another person is receiving it, their delay can be maximum. This is not so much problem. So that's why it is said that there is different delays present. There is different delays from source to destination delay. That example I have taken, that example in time zero, let's say in the time zero, a traffic came at a source. Let's say in time zero, a traffic came at a source and that packet reached its destination. That packet reached its destination at time four. Then the delay will be what? Delay will be 4 time units, because at zero time it is sent and it is received in the 4th time. So that means delay is what? The delay is the 4 unit time. This is basically what delay? This is basically source to destination delay. So delay is another characteristics in the flow of packets of data. Next is the jitter. Now jitter is what? Jitter is the variation of delay. Jitter is the variation of delay. Now let's say example, there is a packet. Let's say there is a packet which have 4 frames. Now inside that packet, we have, let's say, 4 frames present inside that packet. Now inside that packet, there are 4 frames present. So you see 0, 1, 2, 3, these 4 frames are present. Now let's say the first frame received by the, at it reached its destination at 4th unit of time. Then next frame received at the fifth unit of time. Then third frame received at sixth unit of time, and fourth frame reached its at the seventh unit of time. In that case, if we calculate the delay, that means 4 minus 0, the value will be 4. 5 minus 1, the value will be 4. Then 6 minus 2, the value is 4. 7 minus 3, the value is 4. So each frame, it has a delay 4. But in case of the jitter, we have said that the variation and delay. So let's say if in this case we process that the first it is received in the fourth time, the second packet is received in the, let's say, fifth time. Okay, no problem. Then third case, let's say in case of six, if we write it at 8, and in case of 7, we write it as, say, 12. We write it as 12. So that means for first frame, the delay will be what? 4 minus 0, that is 4. In next case, the delay will what? The delay will also same, 5 minus 1, that is 4. But in the third frame, the delay becomes what? 8 minus 2, now the delay becomes 6. And then for the fourth frame, the delay will be what? 12 minus 3, that is 9. So that you see, there's the variation of the delay. This is the variation of the delay. And each frame is what? Each frame is going one another time. So receiving at the destination, reaching its destination in some other time, not in the same time, or same delay is present for that. It is the variation in delay. This is called the jitter. This is what is called the jitter, that is the variation and delay. Now, in audio-video case, but in the audio-video case, jitter should be minimum. Now, let's say how audio-video files go that you are sending. Now, sometimes the video goes fast and then the audio is coming. There is a delay occurring, so that is the variation of the delay. But if you seeing a movie in the online, so in that case, sometimes happen that the video goes fast, but audio goes fast, video is coming later. In that case, the variation of delay occurred. The variation of delay occurred. So for in that case, we should have to be mind that the variation audio video case, because in that case, if it should not be minimum, then what? The video will go fast, the audio will come later. So that means you didn't able to understand what is going on. So that's why the audio video case, the jitter should be the minimum. Okay, so this is our jitter. The jitter says about that. And the last is the bandwidth. Now, bandwidth, already you know that different applications that is present require different bandwidth. It required the different bandwidth. So this four characteristics, reliability, then delay, jitter, and bandwidth, is the flow characteristics present. Okay. So it is clear to everyone.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Or anyone has any question? Others, anyone? If anyone has any question, so then this is about the flow characteristics. Then in the next class, I will discuss, this is the quality of the service and the flow characteristics I have said. In next class, we will see the techniques that is used. This is the flow characteristics, and we say that it should be done. But to techniques